是中文、英文、台语、
客家话。好，我们等一下哈，我们要让那个Jeremy 把他的那个耳麦带上，这样子才方便。好标准，这样就有掌声了，是不是 ？I'm sorry， 这样没有掌声，这样就没有掌声。因为台湾人英文讲好就没有什么用
了。My Mandarin is not as good as Mark Zuckerberg's, unfortunately.
Okay, you can catch up.
Yes.
好，那我们再稍等一下，那请那个耳麦再送过来。好，那在开始之前呢，我先想谈一下我的想法。今天我们很荣幸邀请到孙馆长以及 Jeremy 一起来担任我们早上这场大对谈的语谈人。那大家可能会想到，就是说，哎，这两个人中间到底有什么共通点？有没有人可以告诉我，这两个人中间有什么共通点？除了他们都长得很有型以外，有没有？你觉得这两位我们的讲者中间有什么共同点
？We're all men in black.
Men in black, yes, one. 其中一个哈，都穿着黑色。哎，我也是。好，自己没有发现。还有吗？还有吗？来，他们都关注在教育上面。对，那因为我们有口译啦，所以我尽量还是讲中文。那因为这个大家都那个 Jeremy 还是听得到。好，关注在教育上面。孙馆长他在这个大学授课，那现在更重要的工作当然就是国立自然科学博物馆的馆长，然后与自然科学博物馆的同仁们一起合作，用非常多创新的方式来让不管是小朋友到大人都可以更轻易的以及更轻松的去认识科学这件事情，去爱上科学。 Jeremy 呢，他告诉我们许许多多他在矽谷那边看到的一些案例。那他为什么看了那么多案例，那为什么他不直接投入去做那些事情呢？是因为从他个人的经验，他知道说他想要帮助更多的人去透过城市的设计，结合不同的领域，然后结合他们的专业，然后创造出新的可能，打造出新的创业公司。所以 Jeremy 他从 MIT 离开，跟他的朋友们创立了 Make School， 两个人都专注在这个教育的主题上面。那教育这件事情在现在这个时候变得越来越尴尬。刚才 Jeremy 其实有告诉我们一个很好的例子，这个例子是什么？如果我们现在要重新发明一个从 A 到 B 的方式，那个方式不会是把数万辆车子漆成黄色，然后我们走到路上跟黄色的车子挥手请他停下来。我们现在如果要重新发明一个从 A 到 B 的方式，可能会是更像 Uber 或其他类似的这样一个模式。但是到现在，这些科技反而跟既有的法令产生了争议。我同样想要回到的是教育。如果说我们现在，我们过去，我们就突然忘记好了，我们过去都没有现在我们的学校教育这种方式，我们现在要重新发明一个东西叫做教育的话，那个会是什么？那个会是什么？我想先就这个问题来问我们馆长以及问 Jeremy， 如果我们现在重新发明教育，或甚至是说我们理想中的教育，那应该会是什么？馆长，
我觉得教育如果要能够顺利的开始跟完成的话，它需要有两件事情，一个是动机，一个是乐趣。对现代的人来讲，其他的传统的责任压力那些恐怕都已经不在考虑范围之内了啊。一个是动机，一个是乐趣。我想大家看到我们做的实验，科学展示实验呢，也会觉得如果讲说孙馆长在做教育，我觉得有点高估了。孙馆长只是在分享自己觉得好玩的东西。 Believe or not， 我觉得博物馆就是一个 learning跟 sharing the place， 学习跟分享。学习本身就是一种单纯的喜悦， it's a pure joy。 分享是更高兴的，因为你看到别人因为你乐于跟他分享 knowledge dissemination， 他就得到了收获，很高兴的离去。我觉得那是非常 self rewarding 的事情。但是动机是什么？现代的社会动机已经考虑不到以前我们讲的是说大家要能够高官厚禄，未来能够改善生活翻身的，不是。我觉得很重要的 motivation 也是来自好奇跟乐趣。当然另外一个 incentive 是说你可以赚钱。在这边我想跟大家分享一个 互联网 business 的一个新模型。我不知道大家听过了没有，在大陆上有一种果壳网，上次说过了，他们做了一个新的模型，一个 business model 是什么？芬达。台湾的年轻人一听到芬达就会想到橘子汽水，不是那个芬达，分别回答叫做芬达。芬达是什么？是他们这个互联网的公司找了一些 celebrities， 一些有名的人，然后让大家去问他问题。譬如说章子怡、张艺谋，如果你很好奇张艺谋为什么会搞了一个西湖印象或者是桂林刘三姐，那你就问他问题，在网络上问他说，为什么你会开始桂林刘三姐这个 production。 张艺谋看了说，好，这个问题你要交500块，你要给我500块。好，那如果你乐于在网上支付了500块以后，张艺谋就回答了。他回答的形式可能是一两分钟在网上录了个音回答你的问题。但你知道吗，回答完了以后，他这个录音别人可以来偷听，他们叫偷听，其实就是听。任何人想要听只要付1块钱，任何人想要听只要付1块钱。 maybe 这个问题如果够有趣的话，会有10万人来听，那就会有10万块钱的收入。这家公司拿走2万块，剩下8万块是张艺谋跟这个问问题的人对分。你可以看到这个 business model 吗？ Everybody wins。 所以他有效地把互联网凝结万众众筹的这种过程变成大家一个 incentive， 一个动机，大家就会开始想问有趣的问题。为什么？因为你付了500块钱，可是你赚了4万块。张艺谋回答他也赚钱，每个人花1块钱就能听到有趣的答案。在这个过程中，你看不到一个人损失，另外一个人获得。所以很多时候我觉得教育不得不考虑到这一点，尤其是看到了我们在台湾搞科普，你需要他自给自足，能够自己活得下去。所以无论如何，我们还是要回到 business model， 你找了个商业模式才能做得下去。现在的教育恐怕也是这个样子。
是，有请 Jeremy。
I'm a little distracted by the question that I want to ask Zhang Yimou, but I will do my best to answer the question. So this is actually a very fascinating service. I had not heard of it. It's a very big question. How would you reinvent education? And I think that education has several duties. One fundamental one is to leave students in a better place than it found them. And this is where, in the United States, more than anywhere, education has maybe lost its way. And for many students, the sentiment is that at the end, they're worse off than when they began, primarily due to the rising cost. But when you talk about the content of education or the style of delivery, I think that a lot of the new wave of people trying to reinvent education out of ideology instead of practicality are doing away with some of the really good things that were already there that should have been preserved. And we find when we try to do things the best way for our students, sometimes it's a lecture. Sometimes it's teaching fundamental mathematics. Sometimes it's something completely different, and it varies per topic. But what I think is the most important is to be practical and not dogmatic, not ideological. And in the Valley, it's hard to find people who are not ideological, because if they had some passion to reinvent education, then they're going to come out with strong statements, it all sucks, it has to all be online, or no more lectures ever, or nobody should learn math anymore. I mean, these kinds of silly ideas that are on one extreme or the other. I take a more balanced view. I think what's important is for education to be open about its purpose. If you're going to go into education and that education is not intended to get you a job at the end, but is instead intended to spark deeper knowledge and curiosity in a particular subject, it should be open about that. And frankly, if we're being honest, that is more of a luxury good. People who can afford not to target a very specific outcome, but instead can afford to explore and can afford to understand themselves better, perhaps will purchase this type of education that is more open-ended. But there needs to be options for those who cannot afford that luxury or who don't want that luxury. And I don't see it as an either or. I think that there should be all options available. But when you look at, realistically, in the United States, people who are studying disciplines that do not currently amount directly to a job, but are very expensive, like an English literature diploma at Harvard, It's primarily people who come from wealthy families who already, you know, they're not worried about their future so much. And it's that actually hides how maybe ineffective that education can be, because there's no pressure to make it better if it's just a status symbol and people are okay consuming it because they're not even trying to get a job or a good outcome in the first place. So if you go back to the fundamentals, I think you look at what is this, what does the student aspire to at the end? And this is where implementation matters a lot. Because even if we agreed on the perfect university program, you know, the perfect education, you could still have great professors, and you could still have terrible professors.
Thank you.
And the, no, no, sorry.
You are.
terrible professors. And so what that means is, if one of you went to a school that had the exact same plan, but only terrible professors, and the other one went to a school with only great professors, you could argue all day about how the model is good or bad. And the reality is, it was the implementation that was different. And because there's so many variables involved, I found that some of my old school traditional style, you know, chalk on a blackboard classes at MIT that were taught by an excellent professor were better than classes that were all modern with, you know, IT tools in the classroom where everyone had a tablet and there was, you know, all this fancy technology, but the professor was no good. So going from the fundamentals, what does the student want? Talk to whoever should be the next step. If the student wants to go do research or get a master's, talk to the master's granting institution. If the student wants to be a mechanical engineer, talk to the people who might hire them as a mechanical engineer. If the student wants to be an artist, talk to the folks who are hiring artists. And make sure that you're always measuring that what you're doing feeds correctly into the needs of the next step. Because if you're not doing that, then you're wasting students' time. And what has fundamentally happened is that education institutions have allowed themselves to diverge a little bit because they have not been checking constantly whether they are doing a good job. And at the same time, also ask your students, what do you think? I think there should be ratings on every course. I think that professors that get bad ratings shouldn't teach again. And so you try to work on the content by talking to the destination, whether it's a company or another school. You try to work on the quality by talking to your students and being smart about it, because students like easy classes, of course. You don't want to listen only to students who say, yeah, this was great, I got an automatic perfect score. You want to be intelligent about it. And you think about the best way to deliver given the context of the course. I think that it's entirely possible to self-teach history more than it is possible to self-teach software engineering, for example. Because there's some topics that involve acquiring a lot of information, digesting that information, and then coherently having opinions about information. And there's other topics that involve building or producing something in a multidisciplinary setting or on a team, or synthesizing information to create new things, where maybe having an expert in the room or doing it in a more industry setting is valuable. And this is why you see drastically different completion rates for example, a literature course that is a purely online literature course versus a programming course that is purely online. Because not everything is equal, and certain topics are better taught in certain ways than others. What's important is that we allow folks to experiment, that we measure the results, and that we're honest with ourselves what worked, what didn't. And I can tell you right now, not every class at Make School is perfect. Far from it. We have classes that get bad ratings because we tried something new, and then we're like, oops, let's not do that again. But what's important is we're giving ourselves the freedom to try new things, think about what is the destination, what should the content be, measuring the quality, and iterating always on the format of delivery on a per-course basis, trying to be practical instead of ideological. And at the end, over time, you get closer and closer to maybe not the global right answer, that's the perfect education for everyone, but we know what our target audience is. It's people who really want to be in a physical school and be surrounded by a community and environment, which is most people, right? They want to go to a physical school still. And for that audience, for the people who aspire to the destination that we target, which is jobs in tech in the Silicon Valley, we think we're doing a good job.
好 ，OK， 我另外一个想问题，因为其实刚才谈到教育这件事情，我们想要让教育变得更理想，然后孙冠勇提到，起码要我们要有动机，要有兴趣。那但是我又想回到说，我们整个社会的一个状态，就是我们都知道美国大选刚落幕。然后美国人决定要选出一位比较反科学的 一位总统。我们不知道他未来的立场会怎么变，我们只能就他之前的立场，我们得知他的目前立场是比较 anti-science。 好，It's not your fault. OK， 所以其实在台湾我们也有同样的事情发生，我们也有人会认为说，比如说同性恋如果可以结婚，那世界会灭亡，或是说岛屿会沉没，也有人认为说，就是各式各样的谣言，或者说这些东西，其实在台湾也不少，只是说我们可能还没有选上这样的一个总统，可是我们也可能在往这个路线在走。那你觉得这个是教育的问题吗？或者说如果不是的话，或者说如果是的话，我们应该怎么做？身为一个教育者，你怎么看待这件事情？是否先请孙馆长？
好啊，我觉得美国大选刚落幕 ，Donald Trump 能够当选总统，这是一个非常励志的故事。你就知道，只要你努力，没有什么事情是不可能的。但是
，Maybe I could be president.
Of course, of course.
You too.
可是我觉得
，He should.
No, I don't give it. 但是我觉得很重要的一点是，现在跟以前的教育方式是完全颠倒过来了。以前是老师、学校、authority 是在一个 higher level， 然后 lay out 所有你该学的东西，有 curriculum 大家去学。但现在这一阵子呢，搞教育的人最喜欢讲的三句话是哪三句话？记不记得一副对联跟一个横批？我真的不知道对联跟横批我们的同步口译要把它翻成什么英文。上联是批判性思考Critical thinking， 下联是探究式学习，横批是什么？翻转教育，翻转教室或者翻转教育。每一个搞教育的人这一阵子，海峡两岸 everywhere else 都在讲这几句话，但大家是不是真的了解翻转教育的意义是什么？是把学习的权柄交回去给学生，不是讲交回去，而是交给学生，因为学生从来没有拥有过学习的权柄，交给学生。你会觉得很奇怪，尤其是传统观念底下养成的老师说，为什么学生是主导学习的人？这就是这个时代我觉得给教育的一个新的 definition 了。博物馆观众就变成学习的主体，两个事情，一个是博物馆，一个是学校。我们在博物馆，我希望这种外行人空降到博物馆，对博物馆所造成的伤害远超过一个蛮牛冲进瓷器店里面。为什么？因为它彻底颠覆了博物馆人的想法。我认为台中自然科学博物馆，国立自然科学博物馆在台中，它应该是一个7天24小时开放的地方。为什么？它的资产整个是我们纳税人借购的，每天我们看财务报表呢，它的资产总资产大概是70到80个亿，70到80亿的东西，动产不动产珍贵动产加在一块儿，这么昂贵的东西，1天24小时只开放8小时，我怎么想怎么觉得对不起台湾的民众。台湾人的生活形态已经改变了，你有 7-11， 你有诚品书店，你为什么不能有个24小时开放的博物馆？不会增加人力负担，为什么？全自动绿能智慧化，你可以把博物馆做成一个自己什么时候想进去就可以进去的，身上带的 RFID 展品知道你来了，就会很高兴的打亮了灯，主动开始跟你讲他的故事。每个人可以按照自己的生活步伐安排自己的终身学习，真正把学习的权柄交回去给每一个观众。学校也是，我们做物理表演，像刚刚那些展示，哎，你知道吗？当你不指定学生坐哪里，你要上传统的物理课，学生进来，我发现一个物理定律，永远坐在离老师最远的地方。但你开始桌上摆一堆东西的话，学生就坐在一二排了，开始表演，轰，全部上来了。当你把手放进液态蛋拿出来没事，把花放进液态蛋拿出来没事，学生看到桌上有鸡蛋就会问说，老师那鸡蛋放进去会怎么样？这就是成功的第一步。为什么？因为你引诱了他开始问问题，表示他开始有兴趣了。探究式学习告诉你绝对不要给他答案，你问的问题你自己来做，谁问的问题谁自己来做，老师只在辅导的技巧，辅导的过程上，学生 针对他自己问的问题得到了自己找到的答案，那个知识他会记一辈子。为什么？因为他自己 self-acquired 自己得到的知识。所以你现在知道学生获得的学习的主动权是什么意思了吗？老师只要引起他的兴趣，学生开始主动对这个世界产生好奇，那个知识才是有用的。回家恨不得马上跟父母分享，那才叫有效学习。回家恨不得马上忘掉，那根本没有用。这是为什么我们把传统教育翻转过来，就是要靠把学习的主动权交回去给观众给学生。但前提是什么？有趣有用好玩有动机，这是这样的。
OK Jeremy。
So the U.S. is kind of interesting in that we don't have a centralized education system, really. We have a Department of Education, but they're not a Ministry of Education. They don't set the curriculum. And standards have emerged at various levels, mostly driven by private organizations that have defined what, you know, is required to get into university, and then a certain number of universities have adopted that test, and all of it suddenly becomes the national standard. Butour education system is very fragmented, and it's our strength and it's our weakness. It means that, you know, if a school wants to teach that Jesus rode a dinosaur when he came to discover America, then they can teach that Jesus rode a dinosaur when he came to discover America, and that can be in the school curriculum. And you're not laughing because you think I'm making it up, but, you know, we have a museum dedicated to explaining the story of how Jesus rode a dinosaur to discover America with actual models of
Jesus.
It is not a 24-hour museum. But that one we can keep not 24 hours.
Maybe 1 hour.
Yeah, just a 1 hour museum. So, but here's the thing that we notice on average. Where there is opportunity in the country, the education system tends to be better.And that's for a lot of reasons. Education is funded by local areas, so if people are richer, they pay more taxes, there's more budget to hire more teachers and things like that. But also, the more opportunity there is, the more of a signal there is to schools about what they should be teaching. And though I don't think this is going to happen, the one possible positive thing that Trump might be able to do for education is he might reduce the amount of regulation on what you should teach,which will introduce a lot of variance in the system because people will start teaching all kinds of crazy stuff, but it will make it easier to also start schools that teach good things just as well as it will make it easier to start schools that teach bad things. And if we're able to try and improve access to opportunity around our country, then we can aspire to having educational systems that build towards that opportunity where today there really is not much opportunity. And over time, I think, correct some of the issues that have led to...you know, the election, and it's what we're seeing around the world, honestly. There's a big division between cities and rural areas, between people who have opportunity and people who don't. And the things that you're learning and the way that you're thinking and the way that you see the world and you perceive your own self and what you can be and who you can be as someone in a center of opportunity is so radically different. And we haven't invested enough in ensuring that economic opportunity is spread. I mean, if Facebook and Google had just put, I don't know, 2% of their profits to start education or innovation centers in the middle of the United States to help people acquire the skills they need to get better jobs and things like that, you know, maybe the election would have gone a different way. But right now we have this concentration of opportunity and excitement in big cities around our country in the United States and a concentration of the good schools and the good educational systems that are building towards the good opportunities in all those places.So if we can spread that a bit more, we can be more creative at what we teach and preserve the good things because opportunity creates a signal as to what you should be teaching, I think that there's hope. And this is where universities have a big role to play. What the university sets as a standard distorts the role all the way down to primary education. If you look at countries that have a national test, you know, like, you know, in China, the Gaokao, right? That...just changes, whatever is on that test changes what everyone's doing in high school, what everyone's doing in middle school, what everyone's doing in primary school, because everyone's building towards a destination that was centrally set. And if you have smart people setting it, that can be good. But there's some beauty in our system, which is to allow for experimentation, and the more there can be, perhaps the better system we can find. It's a hard question to answer, but there's no doubt that education has played a large role in how people are perceiving the world and the election choices that they are making.
Okay.
我想说 You really don't have to worry about what Trump would do. You had George Bush, yeah. Right?
Oh, we wish we had him back.
OK, 在这个最后呢，我想再问最后一个问题哈。如果我知道两位都非常的忙碌，都非常的忙碌，包括像 Jeremy 是今天早上才到台湾，然后明天又要飞回去，然后馆长哇，这阵子因为跟馆长见面很多次，他才刚从西藏回来的，隔天就先去参加一场大的活动，然后这个礼拜又被我们找来，可以说非常非常的忙碌，这个身体可能都还没有调养回来，真的很不好意思。但是我想问说，因为其实有时候我们之所以没有去学习，没有去动力，没有这些动力，是因为我们自己觉得自己很忙。我想请问两位，如果说突然两位身上的事情如果都放开了，就假设馆长突然就退休了，假设那个 Jeremy 的公司突然就
倒了，
就停止，你们会去想去学什么东西吗？你们会去想去学什么东西吗？因为其实今天我们这样的一个场合，就很多很多不同的课程，很多很多元的知识的分享者在这边，那我们很希望说大家能够去跨越自己，帮自己盖起来的那座知识的墙，就是说我就是念物理的，所以我对物理有兴趣，我就是念电脑资讯的，我就是对电脑资讯有兴趣，我就去听这个相关的讲者，而不是就是说你会去想去学一个什么东西。我想要问问两位的。
想学的东西太多了，想学的东西太多了。 Actually我觉得，我其实真的觉得，人过了50岁以后，最好的工作就是博物馆的馆长。因为你每天碰到，为什么我到了科博馆，我觉得好高兴。过去这几年，竟然是我20几年大学教授生涯里面最快乐的5年6年，就是因为我的专业跟博物馆完全不一样。我去那边每天眼睛一睁开，就开始学新的东西。各位，你以为我原来知道桃花心木的种子怎么飞吗？那只是一个 tip of the iceberg， 好多关于植物的知识。你以为我原来知道鸟的羽毛为什么会有这种魔鬼粘羽轴羽枝羽小钩能够重新粘在一起魔鬼粘的效果吗？不知道啊。所以那边有太多东西值得我去学的了。我在台大上课，只要下课经过了别的教室，如果那个教室是个大教室，里面坐上几十个人上百个人还没有下课，我就会偷溜进去坐在后面。为什么大班别人不会注意到你，偷溜进去坐在后面，即使听10分钟的课都是好的。为什么？因为到了这个年纪，能够坐下来好好听课的机会太少了。我们走到外面去，自然界每一个现象都是值得学习的东西，本身就像一个 sponge， 一个海绵，这个海绵碰到什么东西都会吸进来。为什么？因为 by this time 到这个时候，我们已经建立了一个 3D 知识立体架构，任何知识进来都很自然的会走到他自己该去的位置。每天知识进来，那就是一个充满乐趣的过程。所以我觉得这是一个人活到后来生命中喜悦主要的来源，更不用说博物馆还提供了给你一个分享的过程。这些东西架构好了以后，你再有条不紊的用有趣轻松的方法把知识 disseminate 出去，让别人也能够分享，让整个社会 somehow better。 我觉得这是人生活的目的非常重要的一个。
来掌声鼓励一下。How about Jeremy?
Oh boy. I actually spend a few hours a week on Wikipedia.
Editing?
Reading.
Reading?
Reading. I'm curious about a lot of things, and I did leave university early. I only did 2 years. In particular, I regret not taking a linguistics class. I was very interested in linguistics, and MIT is one of the best programs in the world, but I left before I had a chance to take that course. I spend hours every week on Wikipedia trying to learn more about the world and how things work. But I had a very specific career aspiration, actually. One that I still haven't let go of, and that I am on an extended detour from this career aspiration. It started when I was in high school. My grandfather, my mother's side, is a filmmaker in Poland. And I got an opportunity to live on the set of one of his movies for a month. And I thought it was the coolest thing in the world, and I'd always enjoyed making short films when I was in high school and things like that. And so I basically decided I'm going to be a filmmaker. I'm going to try to break into Hollywood. And then my parents said, no, that's not going to work. You should go to engineering school. And I was lucky and unlucky enough to be able to get into MIT, which is hard to say no to, but that means it's pulled me away from my goal of going into film. MIT is not a film school. But believe it or not, I managed to find the film course is at MIT. MIT has a media studies department, and they had stolen a professor from Brown University, and they were offering some film courses. And so, you know, I was like, sure, Mom, sure, Dad, I'll go to MIT. And I got there, and I started taking all these film courses. But I ran out of them. And so then the next closest thing was game development and game production, because it was still about creating experiences for other people. And there's a type of game that still tells a story. And that's how I ended up launching a game on the App Store and getting it featured and then leaving to start teaching app development and so on and so forth. So it started with a passion wanting to make films, going into wanting to make games, and then accidentally, you know, going into education. But believe it or not, I had a very specific plan. And honestly, I don't know what would have happened if the plan hadn't succeeded. There is a game studio in Paris called Quantic Dream. And they make games for the PlayStation 3 and soon PlayStation 4 that are the only real interactive movies. So I don't think anyone else in the world has quite figured out how to make an interactive movie yet, except for that studio. And their most successful game was called Heavy Rain. It was actually commercially successful. They sold, tens of millions of dollars worth of copies. So it was very impressive. They made an interactive film, groundbreaking format, and it sold well. And because I grew up speaking French, going to my French-American Chinese school, I thought, well, this is perfect. I speak English, I speak French. I'm going to go work at this game studio in Paris and make interactive movies. And as you can see, I'm not there. But that category of things is still a goal of mine. And the reason that I'm not so worried about being on a detour is I feel like I'm having much bigger and more important impact on the world than if I was just making interesting movies. But also, as it turns out, with the growth of Netflix, with the growth of virtual reality, every year that goes by is actually becoming a better year to go into media and entertainment. And it's turning that world into a more and more democratic place where the idea of having to break into Hollywood is no longer, you know, as relevant. There's so many more ways to get distributed on YouTube, on Netflix, on Hulu, on Amazon, that it's actually becoming increasingly interesting to try and go into that world. And so I haven't let go of it, and if I could learn anything today, if Make School shut down, I would try and go and learn how to make interactive films in virtual reality or something and get them distributed by Netflix or something like that. And I would continue reading Wikipedia on random things a few hours a week until the day I die or the day Wikipedia goes down.
好，掌声鼓励一下。我想，两位最后的一个问题的回答呢，都告诉我们，其实求知欲非常重要。不管你现在几岁，不管你现在在什么样的职业，在什么样的职位，如果你现在，我们就回到前面两个问题一样的角度去思考。如果我们今天才发明一种东西，计程车好了，那它就可能不是计程车。我们今天才重新发明教育的话，它可能跟我们现在想的完全不一样。如果你今天才重新去发现自己到底要做什么，你可能想要学的跟你现在走的路也可能完全不一样。好，有时候这种灵机思考，把过去的基础完全推翻，去想想下一步要做什么，可以帮助我们找到更好的人生道路，以及帮我们选到更好的课。好，今天的这个大对谈就在这边结束，谢谢大家，谢谢，谢谢两位讲者。我们是不是可以邀请两位讲者一起到台下跟我们讲者，我们的参加者一起合个影呢？ Let's take a group photo up here。那我们也请我们的参加者可不可以到中间一点来，然后我们一起跟馆长以及 Jeremy 一起合影，谢谢。感谢大家，麻烦大家移动一下您的位置。来，馆长在中间好了，来，请 Jeremy please be at the center。好，我们请摄影师。好，我们请大家稍微移动一下您的位置，我们一起来跟馆长还有 Jeremy 一起合影，谢谢。感谢大家帮忙，谢谢。我知道大家还有一些人想要去冲去下一堂课。那我们大家就一起看镜头喽，展开微笑。好，谢谢大家，谢谢。